local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
Well, top of the morning to you. Glad you are along. Hope you had a terrific weekend. It is the first day of the week, otherwise known as Monday.
Oh, I thought it was otherwise known as Bada. Bada. I thought that was maybe, you know, let's say Italian for Monday. Bada. Yeah,
there you go. That's how you do it.
Yeah.
And, boy, it's a really misty morning. We're going to see maybe rain, snow kind of mixing in, but nothing really to accumulate. Could get a little slick on the roads. So we're going to have to watch out for that, I guess. A little cooler. Today's high 39, and we're going down to 25 tonight with a chance of snow showers. Now, they were talking about some snow squalls where you could get, like, intense bursts of, you know, showers. I haven't seen any yet. Don't know if we'll get them or not, but we'll keep an
eye. I'm so glad you said. So snow squalls means what?
Well, it's got when a lot of snow comes down in a short period of time.
I thought it was loud crying brought about by snow. So whenever anybody said there were snow squalls, I'm like, is that throughout the neighborhood? Or, you know, like I know it happens in my house, but I didn't realize it happened everywhere else.
Everywhere. Oh. It's widespread.
Yeah. Hey, so much different than what we've experienced through the weekend and going into the weekend where we had some really nice weather. So I assume, and actually we chatted a bit, you got to play a little golf on
Friday. I mean, for December, we've had some pretty mild, and even this week, I mean, even though it's going to be cooler, it's still going to be, you know, sunny on Tuesday and Wednesday. And, you know, we're going to see mid-30s and then back to, like, the low 40s for a few days and, you know, just in time for Christmas. So,
you know what I did with all that really nice weather?
What?
I'd like to say nothing, but I did something. I worked on it all weekend long.
Did you?
You know, as you know, I can imitate, you know, people singing.
Absolutely.
People speaking. And there's a favorite I have. Actually going to bring in producer Tim. Good morning, producer Tim.
Hi, Tim.
Good morning.
And producer Tim has this favorite saying that he says to his wife every day when he leaves the house. He says this particular saying. Don't say it because I want to see if I can nail it. All right?
Okay.
I've been practicing producer Tim saying this particular saying, which I've adopted myself. I like the saying, but I wanted to be able to do it in his voice.
Okay. And so you got to take a deep breath then.
Yeah. I want to see if I get both the saying itself done, done correctly, and if I've nailed his voice at this point.
Okay. I'm going to close my eyes.
Deep breath.
And so I won't know who's saying what.
You give me a count on 3, 2, 1.
Okay. You ready?
Yeah.
3, 2, 1.
Have a whiz-bang day.
That sounds just like him.
I mean,
you've nailed it. That sounds exactly like
him. It's uncanny. Now, I like it because I'll say to people, have a whiz-bang day. Mm-hmm. But then on occasion, now I'll be able to do it in Tim's voice.
You know, and what you don't know is Tim, too, has been working on that saying in your voice.
No, I didn't know that.
Yes. Yeah, he's been working all weekend. He told me this morning, he says, wait, what do you hear this? I think I've got Dave's voice down.
Let's hear it.
Saying
right.
That saying. So
here
are you ready?
Yeah.
3, 2, 1. Still working on it, apparently.
Let's hear it. I'm curious.
All right, it's still a work in progress.
That was a curveball.
Are you embarrassed? I'll try it. I'm sure you're making some progress.
I can't do. I'm really
okay,
working.
You still
on
need
this.
Some
it should
practice.
Not. It should
you
not.
You rolled that one out a little too early. That's okay.
Yeah.
Not everybody.
Monday morning.
No, look. Not everybody is as schooled in doing voices as I am.
I know that.
You know. And again, now you know. When did you reveal this saying to us? It's been months. Mm-hmm. And so first.
I remember, I think it was on one of our share-thons with Debbie Giorgiani. It might have been in the spring.
Yeah. And so first I added it to my lexicon.
Mm-hmm.
And then I thought, well, this is nice to be able to do it in my voice. And I do like it. And I thought it'd be better to do it in Tim's voice if I could pull it off. And again, here it is.
I'm still trying to. No, hold
well,
on.
Let's try it again.
I'm trying to figure out what lexicon means.
Let's try this again. In 3, 2, 1.
Have a whiz-bang day.
I don't think you quite have it yet, Tim. You'll have to work on it a little bit more.
Yes,
Dave is slightly deeper than that.
Yeah,
he's getting there, though. He's definitely getting
he's doing a very good job. I didn't realize his voice was so high-pitched, though. Well, at least my impersonation side.
Yeah, your impersonation.
I would suggest gargling first.
Yeah, right.
Be a good idea.
Yeah, that salt water will always help.
There anyhow, it's a Monday morning offering, and you could probably tell already.
Hey, we're off the rails. Man, didn't even get started.
Doesn't take long, just about 20 minutes away.
I do like that. I want to give producer Tim credit for that, because I think it's an original, is it not?
Yeah.
Have a whiz-bang day. I think it's very
There was
creative.
An episode of MASH where I heard whiz-bang.
Oh, okay.
But it was when Radar was leaving the show.
Yeah.
And Colonel Potter says, we're going to give you one whiz-bang a send-off.
Okay, so you put it in a different context.
But I when I came up with a saying, I didn't even remember that that part of the show until I watched it in a rerun later.
Yeah.
So, mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's
there you go. So you take partial credit.
It entered the lexicon.
Yeah, there you go.
Lexicon.
That's the, the words which you speak.
I can't afford a lexicon. I might buy a used one, but I don't think I can afford a new one.
I was thinking lexicon, Rubicon, they cross the Rubicon. So, that's...
You're getting there.
Yeah.
Well...
It is a Monday morning, isn't it?
I guess so.
It's a Monday after all.
And, Tim, I'm glad you're in studio because we're going to find out what happened today in history. And I know there's always a lot of good stuff that happened, right? So, can you fill us in here?
It was a whiz-bang day in history.
Yes, it was.
Okay. Today in history, on December 18th, 1620, the English ship Mayflower arrives at modern-day Plymouth, Massachusetts, just in time for that stormy winter.
Mm.
And its passengers prepared to begin their new settlement in Plymouth Colony.
Wow.
1865, U.S. Secretary of State William Seward proclaims that the adoption of the 13th Amendment prohibiting slavery throughout the United States.
Mm-hmm.
So he declared that. We go back to 1932, the Chicago Bears. Yes, they went back and played the Portsmouth, Ohio. You have it on your sheet, so I can't really ask you. But their nickname were the Spartans. 9-0 win in the NFL's first playoff game. Not only that, but it was the first game played indoors.
Hmm. My goodness, we haven't had games like that until this weekend. Last couple weekends. 9-0.
Yeah, because of frigid weather and waist-deep snow, the game was moved from Wrigley Field in Chicago to the Chicago Stadium, which used to be the home for the Bulls. And at that time was the home of the city's NHL team.
So they're playing football on the ice.
Yeah, right. Which is appropriate. They would have been playing football on the ice at Soldier's Field,
that's
too.
That's true, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know how they would have laid down the
Wrigley
turf.
Field,
yeah, I don't know how they would have laid down the turf over the ice and everything, but I'm sure they had a way of doing it. 1972, following the breakdown of peace talks with North Vietnam, just a few days earlier, President Nixon announcing the beginning of a massive bombing campaign leading through Christmas to break the stalemate. Nearly 2 weeks, American bombers pounded North Vietnam at that time. Celebrity birthdays, Brad Pitt, 60 years old today. Keith Richards of the Rolling Stones is 80. Steven Spielberg is 77. And actress Katie Holmes is 45.
Toledo native.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Well,
where in Toledo?
Good.
Where did she?
Ottawa Hills.
In Ottawa Hills. Okay.
Oh, okay. Very, very,
very
good.
Nice.
Baked Cookies Day and National Twin Day. So if you have a twin, this is your day.
Well, it ties in nicely because when there's baked cookies, I have to eat two of them.
Well, yeah, always,
to eat
always
twin.
Twin cookies.
Well, that's true.
Is anybody surprised that Keith Richards is only 80 today?
Yeah, it's amazing.
Yeah, I'm thinking, I thought he was 80 like 10 years ago.
Yeah, he was 80 when he was 60.
Yeah, when he was 30.
He set the trend, that so to speak. So.
Happy
so
birthday to all of those folks.
And that's
absolutely
a look at today in history, so history. Thank you very much, Tim.
Hey, yesterday, and getting into a little bit of serious news, real quickly, we'll cover this. You're probably hearing about it on secular news, not as much as we should, though. Father Gabriel Raminelli, the parish priest of the Holy Family Catholic Parish in Gaza, laments the murder by Israeli snipers of two Christian women who had taken refuge in the church compound. This actually from Vatican News. An Israeli sniper shot and killed a mother and a daughter on Saturday. So actually on Saturday, not yesterday. As they left the church building inside the compound of the Holy Family Catholic Parish in Gaza, speaking to Vatican News, the parish priest, Father Raminelli, lamented the murder of his two parishioners. He said the situation already goes beyond tragedy. After the days of truce, the area of Zolotan started to be very active with many bombings. On the night before the attack, bombings intensified in the area around the parish compound, injuring three people inside the church.
Yeah, the Latin Patriarch of Jerusalem released a statement saying an Israeli Defense Forces tank fired a rocket which struck the convent of the Missionaries of Charity, destroying the building's generator and setting off a massive blaze that damaged the house. And then later on Saturday, an Israeli sniper shot Nahida, who was an elderly woman, and her daughter, Samar, who had reportedly exited the church building and were walking toward the sisters' convent. And on Sunday, Pope Francis condemned the attack on the parish, saying there are no terrorists hidden inside, but only families, children, people who are sick and have disabilities, and nuns in the building. Some say this is terrorism. This is war. Yes, it is war. It is terrorism, he said. That is why the scripture affirms that God stops wars, breaks the bow, splinters the spear, from Psalm 46. Let us pray to the Lord for peace.
Yeah, these were a mother and daughter from an active Catholic family. Father Romanelli said he personally knew Nahida and Samar, along with all the parishioners of the Holy Family Parish. He affirmed the mother who was killed, Nahida, and her daughter Samar were very talented people. Nahida was the mother of a large family with many children, almost all married. Among the unmarried children was Samar. The woman who was killed, Samar, was the cook at the convent of the Sisters of Mother Teresa. I mean, this is Mother Teresa's convent there.
Sisters of Charity.
Yeah, both mother and daughter participated in all activities. Father Romanelli added that Nahida was part of the women's confraternity, the St. Anne's group, as well as in other parish groups, often bringing her children and grandchildren. And Samar, too, he said. Samar took on many responsibilities, helped us organize many activities, also with young people and with the St. Anne group. Everyone, the whole Anton family, is very connected to the church and the parish. It's a great sorrow. So one of them is shot. I believe it was the daughter. I'm sorry. I believe it was the mother who was shot. And then Samar, her daughter, went to get her, and they shot her. And then seven other people came, and they shot them. And I'm saying, look, everybody can have their thoughts about Israel's right to defend itself. Of course it has a right to defend itself. Of course it has the right to go and weed out terrorists in areas that to prevent any additional harm, and obviously to try to extract the hostages as well. But why kill these innocent people? This place had been flagged over and over and over again. The patriarch had made clear of the locale of this place so that the Israelis would not attack them. And yet a tank bombed the convent of St. Teresa of Calcutta and then shot people as they came outside. Now, a thing could be wrong and an event can, I mean, a thing could be right. An overall thing can be right and an event be wrong. And I noticed this. This came out on secular news last night, and I checked 2 hours later and it was gone. Can we not be critical of horrible events that the Israelis are doing, of horrible things that the Israeli soldiers are doing? This is murder. This is absolute murder of innocent people. And does that make the whole thing that the Israelis are doing wrong? No, but it makes this wrong. And it should be called out, and these people should be brought to justice. And the American people should not fund something that allows this kind of thing to go on without anyone saying anything about it. It's pulled off the secular news. Why? Because of pressure from other groups in the U.S. No, a thing is wrong that is wrong, and we should be able to call it wrong. And you cannot stand completely behind a thing if there isn't going to be transparency to the whole thing. We require it of our government. Why wouldn't we require it of the government of the Israelis? This is wrong. The patriarch has been upfront from the very beginning that the only people in this parish are those parishioners of the parish. And then, of course, the parishioners who were of the former parish, the Eastern Orthodox Church, that was bombed. And then they moved to this parish. Come on. This is just ridiculous. And there has to be some recompense for this. There has to be some calling out of this thing.
And I believe that there are only two Catholic parishes.
One now. One
now
in Gaza.
One, yes. There were only two to begin with.
Well, that was an Eastern Orthodox church that was annihilated. And then they moved, all the people moved from there into the Catholic Church. And Father Romanelli was talking about how that had brought the communities together. They were praying morning prayer together. They were celebrating Mass together. They were all there as one community praying for the safety of those around them, and of course for their own safety, anticipating the worst, and now some of the worst has come to pass.
Absolutely.
But it's got to stop. And why is it that secular news is covering it, and now you can't find it anywhere?
Yeah,
it's and we can only
guess. We know that there's been a rise of attacks on synagogues and anti-Semitism. Right. I mean, does that give editors the right to say, well, we better not run this story because it's really going to inflame, you know, and maybe create more attacks here? It's still something that needs to be reported.
Yeah, and I hate to say it, it's not the Christians doing either one of them. I mean,
right.
We're just there. We've been there for a couple thousand years, by mm-hmm. the way. We're just there trying to live out our lives in the best way that we can. What we find in the with the Catholics and the Christians in Gaza is they are often the ones who oversee the religious sites. They are the ones, the tour guides and all of that. And they live, you know, very meager lives, but they're there to serve the faith community that comes to visit that area. And I'm just saying, if it's wrong, then if this particular event is wrong, then it's wrong. Mm-hmm. Let it be reported. Let those who participated in it be brought to justice, and then move on with the rest of it.
Mm-hmm.
But don't sweep it under the rug because there's a bigger thing going on. That's my only point.
Exactly.
And the patriarch could not have been in better communication with everyone. That was what he did from the very beginning, as has the Holy Father.
And let's get to the latest news from Wendy Sheridan now. Wendy?
Thank you, gentlemen, and good morning in the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio. I'm Wendy Sheridan. Current U.S. Secretary of Energy and former Michigan Governor Jennifer Granholm visits Toledo today. She'll be joined by U.S. Representative Marcy Kaptur and Toledo Mayor Wade Capsicavich as the group tours the Toledo Water Reclamation Site. The visit will highlight how President Biden's Investing in America agenda is helping local communities become more energy efficient. Early this morning, a central Toledo house went up in flames. It happened in the 1900 block of Parkdale. Neighbors say someone was in the process of moving into the house. A Toledo firefighter was taken to the hospital after he tripped over the fire hose and twisted an ankle. The investigators were called to look into the cause of the fire. Michigan State University has agreed to pay $15 million to the families whose students died in a mass shooting on campus. MSU did not disclose the terms of the settlement. The attorney for the family of Alexandria Verner, one of three families who settled with the school, did say the family agreed to a $5 million payout. Verner, Brian Frazier, and Ariel Anderson were killed, five other students wounded on February 13th when Anthony McRae opened fire on campus. There was a frightening moment as President Biden was walking out of his campaign headquarters in Delaware this weekend. A car plowed into a parked SUV guarding the president's motorcade. The Secret Service ushered Mr. Biden into his armored SUV. The president and the first lady were not hurt. The U.S. is condemning the latest North Korean ballistic missile test. Japan says North Korea fired an ICBM more than 600 miles into the sea. Tokyo says the missile has the potential to travel more than 9,000 miles and possibly reach anywhere in Japan or the U.S. mainland. Israeli airstrikes continue to rain down on Gaza as new images released by Israel show what they say is a large concrete tunnel designed to carry carloads of militant fighters from Gaza right up to the Israeli border. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu seemingly confirmed renewed negotiations led by Qatar to try to free the hostages. Those talks may be underway. Republican voters are showing they're standing behind former President Donald Trump. New polling shows a commanding lead as likely caucus-goers in Iowa find him to be a strong leader. In New Hampshire, he's also out in front with Nikki Haley gaining ground. AAA predicts 115 million Americans will be on the move this Christmas season, many of them this week. Most will travel by car. More than 7 million others are expected to fly. The good news, gas prices are down some. A gallon of regular averages $3.07 nationwide. That's the lowest price in 2 years. The Quaker Oats Company recalling some granola bars and cereals sold nationwide because they could be contaminated with salmonella. Symptoms of the potentially fatal infection include diarrhea, fever, nausea, and abdominal pain. Quaker Oats says no illnesses have been confirmed so far. Information on the specific products under recall and details for reimbursement can be found on the Quaker Oats website. From the WTOL 11 Weather Center, a chance of snow showers today, low 40s, sunshine tomorrow, mid 30s, clouds and sun mixing it up Wednesday, up to the low 40s once again. In the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio, I'm Wendy Sheridan.
We can't have snow yet. The winter doesn't arrive until Thursday.
Yeah. Hold back till then, please.
Welcome to Monday, 37 degrees right now, and the perfect temperature every Monday for virtue. And Pat Odie Murray on the phone with us right now with today's The Virtuous Life program. Good morning, Pat.
Morning, guys. How you doing?
Doing great. How are you, Pat?
I am just fine.
So we're not Al Cresta, but at least we have now. I say this because Pat, you were on with Al Cresta last week.
Yes, I was on with Al Cresta last week. Yeah,
now,
it was fun.
What day was that? Because if folks didn't get to hear it, they can look up Ave Maria's podcast on their website and take a listen.
It was on a Wednesday around the 5 o'clock hour. Yeah, mm-hmm.
Wednesday 5 p.m. So take a listen to Cresta in the afternoon from last Wednesday, and you hear a little conversation with Pat. I thought it was wonderful.
Oh well, good. I'm glad you liked it. It was fun. Yeah,
well, I hope you told him that he can't steal you from it.
Oh, Annunciation is where my heart is. You guys put up with me since 2015, so you win the award.
And you've got a conversation for us this afternoon.
Yes, with Monsignor Bill Kubacki. So we're finishing out kind of the third week of Advent, because again, like Monsignor said, there's only like 6 hours of the fourth week. So yeah. So he and I again talked about some of the readings of St. Thomas Aquinas through the lens of Advent. So it was a great conversation. We had a lot of fun. Yeah.
Well, we look forward to that. You and I were both at the Mass at the cathedral yesterday, and the bishop, Bishop Thomas, was the homilist. And he, you could tell he was a little upset about this short Advent.
Yes.
This is as bad as it gets.
I thought that was really funny. Yeah, he said, I need 5 weeks.
Yeah, right.
3 weeks is not enough for me. You know? So that was a nice Mass, too. Where were you, Dave? I didn't see you.
Yeah, so Eileen has this pew staked out on the left-hand side if you're facing the altar, about eight pews back. Eight pews back.
Okay. Right? Exactly, eight right. pews back.
Oh, it's the same exactly pew every single Sunday morning. Yep, yep.
Now, are you on the aisle or are you in the middle?
We're on the aisle on the far left-hand side.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're on the side aisle. Well, I'll have to look for you when I show up at the cathedral. Yeah, that was really nice. I didn't know they did that, you know, kind of Mass for seminarians and parents and
stuff
like that. That was very nice.
Yeah, and so that again, what Pat is describing is the seminarians were there yesterday with their families.
Oh, neat.
An
mm-hmm.
annual event, and this is the Sunday before they go on their Christmas break. So this is to kind of do a huddle before they go.
Pretty cool.
Yeah, I thought that was really a nice thing to do. So I just showed up because I thought, I haven't been to the cathedral, in a few weeks. So I showed up to see what was going on. So I kind of stumbled into that.
Neat. So last week you had Monsignor Tad Oxley on The Virtuous Life. And this week you've got Monsignor William Kubacki.
Yep.
So back-to-back Monsignors, that's quite a coup.
I know. I'm fortunate because, well, I knew them all before they were Monsignors. So, that always helps,
Yeah, absolutely.
Bill and I were tracing our roots at one point during the interview and more of a conversation. And he said, oh, Pat, off air, then he told me, geez, I wasn't ordained all that long the first retreat we did together. And I'm like, really? I didn't, it has been quite a while. Yeah. So, yep, I knew those guys. He called himself a baby priest, so.
I hear of conversations going around, and one that I heard of was someone speaking to you saying, how does it feel to interview all of these highfalutin people on your program and all these wonderful priests that you're surrounded by throughout the diocese? How do you remain humble? And they said, they said back to me that what you said is, I go on with Ron and Dave every once in a while.
I can do anything.
4 o'clock this afternoon, The Virtuous Life with Pat Odie Murray. Thanks for getting up early and sharing the show with us.
Thank you,
no
Pat.
No problem. You guys have a good third week of Advent.
You too.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Oh, what a great show. Looking forward to that this afternoon at 4 o'clock. And looking forward to the 8 o'clock hour here on Morning Offering.
And look up that conversation with Chris in the afternoon. I think you'll enjoy it.
Yeah, last Wednesday. 5 p.m.
Started drinking beer on Saturday nights, sleeping in on Sunday mornings, missing Mass, and it just became a pattern and continued. Without God, I don't know where I'd be right now. I feel like I'm whole again. I know the importance of the Eucharist. I know the importance of the sacraments that I didn't know at a young age. I follow God's will because my desire is to get to heaven. Our lives are rich and full by being members of the church.
If you've been away from the Catholic Church, visit CatholicsComeHome.org.
Morning Offering is proudly sponsored by Carpets by Otto, with 3 locations serving Northwest Ohio. Thank you for supporting Annunciation Radio.
Catholic Radio for the Diocese of Toledo. This is Annunciation Radio. WNOC Bowling Green Toledo. WHRQ Sandusky. WRRO Eden Bryant. WFOT Lexington Mansfield. And WSHB Willard.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
Hi, Dave.
Good morning, Ron.
Hi, Tim.
Good morning, Ron.
That's all I've got to say.
It's about all I've got.
A beautiful day in the neighborhood today, if you don't mind a little snow.
It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood if
gonna
you've
be
got
windy
your coat,
today,
hats,
too.
And gloves.
Man, the wind's going to kick up as we go through the day today. So
yeah.
Going to feel downright wintry. And again, Thursday is when winter officially arrives.
And we were all up early this morning and out. Now, of course, you have the blessing of a garage, but you still have to get outside.
Mm-hmm.
It was a little chilly when I exited the house this morning to get into my car.
And Monday's Morning Offering really has a ton of features that love. You're going to have your Word of the Day coming up.
We have Word of the Day. We've got a little bet you didn't know that. I know I didn't. Heroes of the Faith. We've got Maggie McDaniel, and if we are able to successfully connect with her, she's in Italy.
Oh.
So that's going to be a wonderful conversation with her.
Absolutely.
Of course, on Mondays, we have the one and the only Father Mark Davis coming in the house with his thoughts on our Word of the Day. We love our Mondays.
Mm-hmm. A lot of fun.
Yeah, but we also have real or fake headlines. That's what we start with each and every Monday at the top of the hour. Now, do we have real or fake headlines today? Is that
fake? Well, we do, but I can give you a choice, too, because I know sometimes you like to mix it up a little bit.
Yeah.
We haven't done Name of the Game for a while. We, of course, got One Doesn't Belong, and we've got the fake news.
Name That Game. So name That Game is... I'm horrible at all of them, but Name That Game, I'm better at than most.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we can do that.
What do you think, Producer Tim? Go with Name That Game?
That's my worst game.
Yeah, let's
do
that.
All right. Well,
because anytime I can look good and Producer Tim can
look
not as smart as he usually looks, I'm good with that.
Could be a card game, could be a board game, any sort of game, really. But
Scrabble.
Name of the Game is the name of the game here.
Oh, okay.
You have to tell me. I'll give you a description. You tell me what game it is.
Okay.
Ready?
Yep.
One false move and it all comes crashing down.
Oh, one false. You built Jenga.
Jenga.
There you go.
Yeah. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, it's
really
Jenga.
Absolutely right. Yeah, that's it. See?
Have you played the Monster Jenga?
I have. Oh, those big ones?
Oh, my goodness. A lot of fun.
Oh,
yeah.
That's scary.
A lot of fun with a group playing the Monster. Because honestly, somebody could get hurt. And it just adds to the excitement.
My family dug me out half a day later.
Yeah, there you go.
I have memories. All right, let's see. We got one right here. One out of one. You can be Molly Mallow or Giggly Gumdrop in this tasty place.
Oh, it's Candyland.
Of course it's Candyland.
It's Candyland.
There you go. See, very good.
Sorry, Tim.
It's okay.
Yeah. See, Tim reads, so he knows a lot. I play children's board games.
All right, Tim, maybe a sports-related question for Tim.
Okay.
In this game, you kick with your hand and wrist.
paper football.
Yeah. Paper football?
Table football.
Table football?
Yeah.
But it's all the same. It's
Is it known by any other name?
It's usually called, as he said, it's paper football.
Yeah. Oh, paper football.
Yeah, because you fold the paper. Yeah,
that's it. And then you do that. But you just flick with your finger with that.
Oh, so this is not the game.
Yeah, that's not wrist.
That's not hand and wrist.
Oh, yeah, hand and wrist is paper football.
You're doing it wrong if you're playing paper football with your wrist and your hand.
Well, no, but then you do bam. That's when you kick the field goal.
Yeah,
there's really
no wrist. It's wrist, and then it's hand.
Yeah, you can try to justify that all you want. It's wrong.
Is that right?
So what would it be?
Oh, so you have a different one.
Well, yeah.
Hand and wrist is a different sports game.
In this game, you kick with your hand and wrist.
It's foosball. Hand and wrist.
Yeah.
Is foosball. Foosball.
Where's the, I guess
foosball.
I would say
of
that.
Of course it's foosball.
Very good. See? Aren't you glad we played that game?
Let's go back to my great
school. You guys went 3-0 there. Yeah, that's pretty good.
There you go.
Well, it's all Dave.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah. Now, look,
I take
this back to the college days when you go into the bar. And, of course, what are you playing in the bar? Candyland.
Absolutely.
And I would win with great regularity. And so there you go.
Hey, Giggly Gumdrop.
That must have been some happening place.
That was a happening place down at the on the campus of The Ohio State University.
Good stuff.
Yep,
so we haven't played that game in a while, so it's good to see you're not rusty.
Yep, there you go. I like it. I'm glad we chose that one because, honestly, and you can attest to this, Producer Tim, and I'm sure this is in your lexicon as well. I'm not good at the rest of them. I mean, I'm really not. I struggle with the rest because they take actual intelligence, and since mine is made up, it doesn't equate well with actual questions. But the games,
I'm happy to take one for the team.
Thank you for your generosity.
Look good and makes us look good.
Yeah.
So on Mondays, frankly, you want something a little easier.
Yeah, I want the Mondays. Easy stuff. Yeah, there you go.
Takes a while to get in the group.
Yeah, I like to be the questionnaire instead of the questioned.
Ah.
Yeah.
Oh,
I like to be Alex Trebek.
Yeah, you like the Tuesdays then.
Yeah.
The Tuesday trivia.
And look, that is the mother of them all. That's the one that started it all.
That's right.
And so, yeah, I was in my very comfortable place when someone else said, hey, how about we turn the tables? And I thought, well, no, I don't think I would like that. But you guys did it anyway.
Oh, yeah, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, that seat can get awful.
Four more days to work with here. So
I was outvoted.
All right. Well, congratulations. Well done, Dave.
Thank you very much.
Here's our morning offering prayer.
My God, I adore you, and I love you with all my heart. I thank you for having created me, made me a Christian, and preserved me this night. I offer you the actions of this day. Grant that all of them may be in accordance with your holy will and for your greater glory. Protect me from sin and from all evil. Let your grace be always with me and with all my dear loves. Amen.
Amen. And thank you. We continue our prayers. We join parents of priests and pray for our clergy and religious. We pray for vocations and for an increase of faith so as to become a more holy diocese of Toledo. Today we pray for Reverend Monsignor Marv Borger.
Dear Lord, we pray that the Blessed Mother wrap her mantle around your priest to follow her own words, do whatever he tells you. May your priests have the heart of St. Joseph, Mary's most chaste spouse. May the Blessed Mother's own pierced heart inspire them to embrace all who suffer at the foot of the cross. May your priest be holy, filled with the fire of your love, seeking nothing but your greater glory and the salvation of souls. Amen. St. John Vianney,
pray for us.
And we add a Hail Mary for the intention of increased vocations here in the Diocese of Toledo. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. And our word for today on this Monday of the third week of Advent, this Monday, December the 18th, our word for today is rescue. Rescue, our word for today, our reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. chapter 23. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up a righteous shoot to David. As king he shall reign and govern wisely. He shall do what is just and right in the land. In his days Judah shall be saved, Israel shall dwell in security. This is the name they give him, the Lord our justice. Therefore the days will come, says the Lord, when they shall no longer say, as the Lord lives, who brought the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, but rather, as the Lord lives, who brought the descendants of the house of Israel up from the land of the north, and from the lands to which I banished them, they shall again live on their own land. Our responsorial psalm, Psalm 72, Justice shall flourish in his time and fullness of peace forever. O God, with your judgment endow the king, and with your justice the king's son. He shall govern your people with justice and your afflicted ones with judgment. For he shall rescue the poor when he cries out, and the afflicted when he has no one to help him. He shall have pity for the lowly and the poor. The lives of the poor he shall save. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who alone does wondrous deeds, and blessed forever be his glorious name. May the whole earth be filled with his glory.
Alleluia, alleluia. O leader of the house of Israel, giver of the law to Moses on Sinai, come to rescue us with your mighty power. Alleluia, alleluia. Our Holy Gospel from Matthew chapter 1. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. When his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found with child through the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her husband, since he was a righteous man, yet unwilling to expose her to shame, decided to divorce her quietly. Such was his intention when, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary your wife into your home. For it is through the Holy Spirit that this child has been conceived in her. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "Behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke, he did as the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and took his wife into his home. He had no relations with her until she bore a son, and he named him Jesus.
In our word for today, rescue, our Holy Father's thoughts regarding today's gospel reading, these he shared at his Angelus address on this date in 2016. The gospel passage shows us two people, the two people who more than anyone else were involved in this mystery of love, the Virgin Mary and her husband Joseph. These two figures, Mary and Joseph, who were the first to welcome Jesus through faith, introduce us to the mystery of Christmas. Mary helps us to assume an attitude of openness in order to welcome the Son of God into our concrete life, in our flesh. Joseph spurs us to always seek God's will and to follow it with full trust. Both allow God to draw near to them. And to God who draws near, do I open the door to the Lord when I sense an interior inspiration, when I hear him ask me to do something more or for others, when he calls me to pray. God with us, God who draws near, this message of hope, which is fulfilled at Christmas, leads to fulfillment of the expectation of God in each one of us too, in all the church and in the many little ones whom the world scorns, but whom God also loves and to whom God draws near. God draws near. He is there to comfort us in the midst of our despair, in the midst of our discouragement. Rescue, our word for today. And wow, there's so much in this gospel reading that is between the lines. So let's begin. This is how the birth of Jesus, again, this is first chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. This is how the birth of Jesus came about. When his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found with child through the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her husband, since he was a righteous man, yet unwilling to expose her to shame, decided to divorce her quietly. So, there we go. This is the beginning of the Gospel of Matthew. We know what has happened. Mary has been visited by the angel, and she has accepted being the mother of the Lord. And she's also told that Elizabeth is pregnant. Her cousin Elizabeth is pregnant. So she goes to visit her cousin Elizabeth and stays for some time. So she's there all the way through the birth of John the Baptist, and then she returns home. Very pregnant. Now, Joseph had not accompanied her to Elizabeth. So Joseph says goodbye to his betrothed, and she goes off to visit her cousin Elizabeth. And then 6 months later, she comes back very, very pregnant. And now the righteous man, Joseph, is looking at a pregnant Mary, and he is completely aware of what is required for a pregnancy to take place. And so this is where we pick up the story. That's all, everything that happened between the lines right there.
Hmm.
So now you have Joseph. The other thing we're not told is how long this takes place. So Joseph sees Mary. She's very pregnant. And now he is in distress. And I'm sure as a man of God, he is crying out to God, God, I thought this arrangement was from you. This idea that the two of us would come together and love one another, but serve you primarily, living out chaste lives together. I have accepted this. I love this. I love her. And here she is pregnant, very pregnant. And what am I to do? Well, the law is clear. The law, brothers and sisters, is clear. Let me make it clear. The law is clear what Joseph is to do. He is to let people know that Mary is pregnant and that he is not the father. She is to be stoned. He is cleansed. He walks with his head held high among the Jewish people. She is shamed and put to death. And no guilt is found in him. That's the law. That's the expectation of everyone around him. And yet she comes back betrothed and yet not living with him, pregnant. So what does everyone assume when Mary comes back? That they had beat the clock by a little bit. And that she had gone away and was pregnant when she left. And so there's already this shame about something that has come about before it's time to come about. But there's reconciliation. There's a way to get past that. But Joseph looks at the whole situation and says, you know what I'm going to do? I'm not going to follow the law. I'm going to break the law. And I'm going to divorce her quietly. I'm not going to tell anybody that that is not my baby. I'm just going to disregard them. I'm going to walk away. Who in that case, brothers and sisters, is shamed? Who is cast out? Not Mary. Joseph. Joseph is making the decision that he will humiliate himself. He will break the law. This righteous man will break the law in order to protect Mary. Now, again, he has no idea how the pregnancy came about. Can you see Mary trying to explain this to him? No, she doesn't. She shows up pregnant. And so it is incumbent upon the Lord himself to come and straighten this whole thing out. So he sends an angel, and the angel explains everything to Joseph. And then Joseph moves forward in this role that he's been invited, encouraged to participate in. But first, his righteousness was tested. And what he decided to do before he knew anything else was to divorce her quietly and take the entirety of the humiliation upon himself. Again, if they had followed the law, if he was a strict purveyor of the law, if he absolutely said the law comes first, might sound familiar today. The law comes first. Nothing supersedes the law. Both Mary would have been stoned to death and Jesus would have died in her womb at the stoning. That is what is prescribed. That is what would have happened if he had followed the law. But instead, he chose to take the humiliation upon himself to be a deadbeat dad in the eyes of his Jewish brothers and sisters, the absolute opposite of everything we know about Joseph, but he was willing to take it on so that Mary's life would be spared, so that the unborn child's life would be spared. he would take that humiliation upon himself and do the thing that he was not accustomed to doing at all, break the law in order to protect both she and the unborn baby. And then the angel appears and says, Joseph, righteous Joseph, the reason you are chosen is exactly because of the decision you just made, because that's the kind of man you are. Now you are chosen to be the father of the Lord, to be the protector of both Mary and Jesus, because you are a righteous man. Something to keep in mind as part of the rescue. Before Jesus could come, before he could make himself present to us, he needed the righteous man Joseph to be there to stand in the gap for both he and his mother, to protect them, even when the law would say, even when the religious law of the day would say, she must die and he must die, he stepped forward to rescue them, that Jesus might rescue us all. Rescue, our word for today.
Awesome insights.
Yeah, I mean, and look, this is a man who's well-respected. He's of the line of David. He's royalty. Mm-hmm. And yet he was willing to say, you know what? No. Even though I know the kind of man I am, I know how people see me, I'm willing to walk away from all of that and be absolutely held in disdain that she might not die.
Thank God for
that dream.
And the baby
within her womb might not die. And then, then the angel came and bailed him out. So it's all good.
Thanks, Dave. And, of course, Father Mark Davis on The Mark with Father Mark a little later, offering his insights into today's Word of the Day.
Looking forward to that.
And we're going to find out where in the world is Maggie McDaniel right after we find out what in the world is on the news desk of Wendy Sheridan.
Thank you, gentlemen, and good morning in the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio. I'm Wendy Sheridan. Current U.S. Secretary of Energy and former Michigan Governor Jennifer Granholm visits Toledo today. She'll be joined by U.S. Representative Marcy Kaptur and Toledo Mayor Wade Capsicavich as the group tours the Toledo Water Reclamation Site. The visit will highlight how President Biden's Investing in America agenda is helping local communities become more energy efficient. Early this morning, a central Toledo house went up in flames. It happened in the 1900 block of Parkdale. Neighbors say someone was in the process of moving into the house. A Toledo firefighter was taken to the hospital after he tripped over the fire hose and twisted an ankle. The investigators were called to look into the cause of the fire. Michigan State University has agreed to pay $15 million to the families whose students died in a mass shooting on campus. MSU did not disclose the terms of the settlement. The attorney for the family of Alexandria Verner, one of three families who settled with the school, did say the family agreed to a $5 million payout. Verner, Brian Frazier, and Ariel Anderson were killed, five other students wounded on February 13th when Anthony McCray opened fire on campus. There was a frightening moment as President Biden was walking out of his campaign headquarters in Delaware this weekend. A car plowed into a parked SUV guarding the president's motorcade. The Secret Service ushered Mr. Biden into his armored SUV. The president and the first lady were not hurt. The U.S. is condemning the latest North Korean ballistic missile test. Japan says North Korea fired an ICBM more than 600 miles into the sea. Tokyo says the missile has the potential to travel more than 9,000 miles and possibly reach anywhere in Japan or the U.S. mainland. Israeli airstrikes continue to rain down on Gaza as new images released by Israel show what they say is a large concrete tunnel designed to carry carloads of militant fighters from Gaza right up to the Israeli border. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu seemingly confirmed renewed negotiations led by Qatar to try to free the hostages. Those talks may be underway. Republican voters are showing they're standing behind former President Donald Trump. New polling shows a commanding lead as likely caucus-goers in Iowa find him to be a strong leader. In New Hampshire, he's also out in front with Nikki Haley gaining ground. AAA predicts 115 million Americans will be on the move this Christmas season, many of them this week. Most will travel by car. More than 7 million others are expected to fly. The good news, gas prices are down some. A gallon of regular averages $3.07 nationwide. That's the lowest price in 2 years. The Quaker Oats Company recalling some granola bars and cereals sold nationwide because they could be contaminated with salmonella. Symptoms of the potentially fatal infection include diarrhea, fever, nausea, and abdominal pain. Quaker Oats says no illnesses have been confirmed so far. Information on the specific products under recall and details for reimbursement can be found on the Quaker Oats website. From the WTOL 11 Weather Center, a chance of snow showers today, low 40s, sunshine tomorrow, mid 30s, clouds and sun mixing it up Wednesday, up to the low 40s once again. In the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio, I'm Wendy Sheridan.
Thank you, Wendy. 36 degrees
it's
right
raining,
now.
It's raining. It's snowing. It's snowing. I said it's snowing.
Is
I
it
see
snowing?
Snow. Yeah, oh, I see snowing. Snowflakes coming down.
In most of these parts.
You'll and see then I see something else.
Where in the world is Maggie McDaniel?
You turn your computer
where
on. You can barely hear that.
Where in the world is Maggie McDaniel?
Where is she? Where is she?
Now,
where is she?
I thought she was in Italy, but nay, no. She's right here with us. Buongiorno.
She's in Little Italy.
Yes, yeah.
So welcome welcome to
right
the studio.
Which is right off
Airport Highway. Yeah. I got it wrong by a couple of weeks. You're leaving after the first of the year, on the first of the year.
Yes, actually on January 1st.
To head to Italy. You and I were talking off mic, and you, having been to the Holy Land so many times, you've got some other connections there. And I would assume this one, you got a letter from the Latin Patriarch about the incident on Saturday in the Holy Land. That's probably more associated with your...
With the Equestrian Order, yeah, the Holy Sepulchre.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, we actually, they keep us informed, and about every 2 weeks we get about a 30-minute video that's been recorded from the executive there at the Latin Patriarch, and keeping us up to date on what's going on. But the other thing, and thank you for sharing that this morning, I think it's very important for people to know that innocent people are being hurt unnecessarily.
Targeted.
Christians, and the biggest reason is just because they're Arab, they're Palestinian, they're Christians, though, you know, and it wouldn't matter.
Right.
They're innocent people
right.
that are being hurt. But also the other thing with the shooting, they also bombed the Sisters of Charity home that houses 54 disabled people, along with their generator, their water supply, and everything else. Now there are 54 disabled people displaced.
Because they destroyed the generator.
Because they destroyed it. Yes. What do you do with them? They need
goodness.
Equipment, metal equipment. They cannot get around on their own. The Sisters of Charity take care of them.
Mm.
And that was another reason, too, when they were asked, you know, at the beginning to move, how do you move all
right.
these people?
And that's why
where
the sisters refused
a,
to leave.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
They have a mission to take care of these people. And now...
And this is exactly
it's
what
senseless.
Happened, is the two women, the mother and the daughter, were going from the church to the convent, because the convent had been bombed.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's
a
mess.
Yeah.
And, you know, you talk about rescue. They need rescued.
Mm.
And they need prayers. And I think another thing that this does, I mean, when I read the letter, it made me sick to my stomach. But it's like, we don't know what true suffering is.
No.
We
yeah,
don't know
you're
what
right.
it's like to go without something. If the power goes off because of an ice storm or an accident for a couple hours, we're mad at the
we're
world.
Beside ourselves.
They're talking about since October 7th being bombed, not knowing where they're next, if they're going to have food and water. And now this isn't fixed overnight.
No, right.
This isn't fixed overnight. The only generator they had left is now gone.
Wow.
And they're disabled
there'd be no
people.
Hope of getting another one. I mean,
no.
Well,
no.
Here's the point. We don't know Nahida and we don't know Samar. If we knew them, we'd be brokenhearted today. Now, we should be brokenhearted anyway.
Oh, they're brothers and sisters.
But imagine all of their
sisters.
Family members, the people that know them, and people like you who get over to regions and get to know people individually. You do know people over there.
Absolutely.
You do know people who have been affected. It's a different situation when it becomes personal.
It is. And that's something, though, hopefully through our faith, that we can still feel some type of a connection to them, even if we've never been there, even if we've never met them. Because they are our brothers and sisters in our faith.
Yeah.
They're children of God just like we are.
Yeah. And I feel like, one, we're getting to know the patriarch a little bit, but we're also getting to know Father Romanelli, the pastor there at Holy Family. He's communicating. The Holy Father calls there every day.
Yes.
Every afternoon he calls there to check in on them. And then this came about. He put forward a pretty incent statement too. Just say, well, come on, guys, the flags have been raised. Everybody, he says, there are no terrorists there.
No.
We have confirmed, reconfirmed, there are not terrorists there. There are people there who are just struggling to stay alive.
Absolutely. Mm. Yeah, absolutely. So, no, it's a very, very sad situation. And, you know, they need help. They need prayers. They need help. We need this war to stop. They need mm-hmm. funds. And that's one thing that our order does is we raise, you know, the money we raise is to just support them in a normal, everyday way. But we've been actually actively soliciting and trying to collect money to send for humanitarian aid. And it goes right to the Land Patriarch, and it gets right to the people who need it.
Praise God.
Yes.
Now, how do you do that?
Well, we send it to the treasurer of our lieutenancy. So if anybody wants information on that, please reach out to me.
And it gets right to them.
And, yeah, I've sent emails to everybody that I've taken to the Holy Land through our group emails. Mm. I usually do not like to solicit people and send them stuff, but this was a unique situation. Yeah. And the letter I got back from our treasurer is a lot of people did respond and were very generous. But this is ongoing, and they need, obviously, continuous help.
Now, for those that are not members of the Sequestrian Order of the Holy Sepulchre, is that what it's called? Can they donate?
Yeah, absolutely. And what they do is they still make out the check to the Sequestrian Order of the Holy Sepulchre, and we send it in and make sure just humanitarian aid is put in the memo, and I can give you the address to send it to. They can mail it to me, and I've had people mail me the checks, and I just send them directly to the order. And they know that you're not members, but you're trying to just help.
Mm-hmm. Welcome to support this cause. And now here's the thing. We should all take a pilgrimage this Christmas season, the rest of this Advent, coming into the Christmas season, to the Holy Land, in our minds, in our spirits, in our hearts, to be with our brothers and sisters who are suffering, our Christian brothers and sisters who are suffering at Holy Family, our Jewish brothers and sisters who are suffering throughout Israel, also being attacked by terrorists and suffering violence because of this war. And then, of course, all the Palestinian people who are under great threat of life, our Muslim brothers and sisters as well, that there would not be this absolute slaughter of innocent life in the midst of this war, and that this war would end quickly, that violence, the cessation of violence would come quickly, as our Holy Father has asked for, has prayed for, and has even offered to intervene in.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and the sad part, what's going on in Gaza is just, you know, it's, you can't even comprehend it. But then, like you said, the innocent people, the people in Bethlehem have been locked in since October 7th.
Yeah.
If they had jobs outside of Bethlehem where they were allowed to come and go, they can't come and go.
Right.
And so financially, everybody's hurting, but of course the people who are in the midst of the bombing, they're hurting the worst.
Wow. And the Holy Father in his Angelus address yesterday reminded everyone, yes, we're praying for all of those in Holy Land. We continue to pray for those in Ukraine. We continue to pray for those in violence throughout the world.
Maggie McDaniel, thank you.
God bless, guys.
Merry Christmas.
Hello, this is Pat Odie Murray from The Virtuous Life. I hope you'll join us for our next show as Monsignor William Kubacki will be with us as we continue to discuss St. Thomas Aquinas during the season of Advent. So join us, won't you, Mondays and Saturdays at 4 p.m. here on Annunciation Radio.
The Catholic Church teaches that Jesus Christ is literally and wholly present, body and blood, soul and divinity, under the appearances of bread and wine. St. John the Apostle records the John chapter 6 Bread of Life discourse in which Jesus states that his flesh is true food and his blood true drink. Who better to understand John's writings and subsequent teachings than a disciple and student of John, St. Ignatius of Antioch? In his letter to the Smyrnians in 110 AD, Ignatius writes, "I have no taste for corruptible food, nor for the pleasures of this life. I desire the bread of God, which is the flesh of Jesus Christ. And for drink, I desire his blood, which is love incorruptible." The Catholic Church absolutely follows St. John and St. Ignatius in taking Jesus at his word. Examining the truths of the Catholic faith, this is faithforensics.org.
Do you have something you'd like to ask our bishop? Most Reverend Daniel E. Thomas answers questions from our listeners each and every week on the Bishop's Corner. Send in your questions about the faith, today's cultural trends, diocesan news and events, prayer life, anything on your mind. Click the Bishop's Corner tab at AnnunciationRadio.com or on our app and listen for his answer Thursdays at 4:30 p.m., Fridays at 11, and Saturdays at noon on Annunciation Radio.
This program is underwritten in part by the law firm of Klein, Cook, and Weisenberger, now located in Perrysburg, Ohio. Online at ccw-law.com.
419-321-6444.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
Monday, and a wonderful visit with Maggie McDaniel, and we don't really get to see her again because she's going to be traveling. She's going to be in Italy. We'll get her on the phone in a couple of weeks.
Yeah, and just a reminder, we won't be here next week.
Right,
between
the whole week we'll be gone. We'll be out of here.
Christmas Day.
Not until Tuesday the 2nd do we
so we're going to be off
these microphones again.
Away from you for six shows. We won't be here for the entirety of next week, and then, as Ron said, for the 1st. But then we pick up with Maggie on January the 8th, and that is when she'll be in Italy.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll be checking in with her from there. So not in person with us until, I think, the following Monday. So
yeah.
Look forward to that.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And let's see here. Being Monday, it's always kind of interesting. You get an opportunity to kind of reset for the week.
Yeah.
On Mondays, which is a rare opportunity. So say what you want. Lament all you want about Mondays. There's a good reason to have them.
Well, yeah, because if you don't have Monday, you can't get to Friday.
That's true.
Well, that's what I'm thinking. I mean, you might have a better reason, but that one does it for me.
You got to have the Monday.
Yeah.
We've got a Bet You Didn't Know That. I know I didn't coming up. We've got, of course, Heroes of the Faith coming up. We've got Word of the Day with Father Mark Davis.
All yet to come.
Yeah.
I mean, we've got Father Mark Davis in just 14 minutes, mm-hmm. so we've got to get to the rest of that stuff right now to get it in. I got a little, I bet you didn't know that. I know I didn't. How about this one? Why do we get goosebumps?
I don't know why.
In this psychological reaction, small muscles attached to individual body hairs contract, which leads the hair to stand on end. That's what physically happens. So now we know what happens, but why do we get them?
Mm-hmm.
But as George Bubinek, a psychologist and professor of zoology at the
George.
University of Guelph in Ontario, Canada, explained to Scientific American. So I want to say this sentence one more time. But as Bubinek, a psychologist and professor of zoology at the University of Guelph in Ontario, Canada, in Ontario, Canada, explained to Scientific American. There are like three contradictions.
Yeah, really, there are.
He's a zoologist.
Yeah.
Why is he explaining to us about goosebumps?
Yeah.
He's a Canadian speaking to a Scientific American.
Hmm.
And you say university how?
I think it's in the flowers because in Guelph, Ontario, have you ever been?
Guelph, no.
They have a floral clock.
Okay. I've seen.
So I think there's something in the pollen there.
Okay, so this is what he said. It also caused our ancestors, who had much more hair on their bodies than we do today, to appear bigger than they were, helping to ward off predators when they were frightened or on the defense.
Now, I don't know if I buy that.
Look, he's Canadian.
He's a zoologist.
He's Canadian. He's speaking to Scientific American, and he's a zoologist.
I guess we got to believe
him. You put
him.
All of that together, and it makes no sense to me that he would be the one commenting on this. But maybe so.
True.
Maybe so.
Must be true.
With modern humans having less body hair, goosebumps no longer cause us to look that much more intimidating. Well, I agree with that.
Yeah.
But that doesn't, well, it does. Okay, let's say that his theory is correct. It does make sense that sometimes you get goosebumps for no reason. You just feel like there's, you know, something around you or some situation causes you to get goosebumps. It does heighten your awareness. You know, you are at a heightened awareness when you get the goosebumps.
That's true.
Either
like
that
your
or you're cold.
Yeah.
I mean, so I don't know. Some of it makes sense. Some of it doesn't.
Interesting.
Yeah, I think Bubinek, maybe not. Maybe so. How about this one? Now some things are factual, absolutely, and they can't be argued.
Indisputable.
Like this one, Superman didn't always fly. There's evidence for this, and I'm about to give you the evidence.
Hmm.
The original comic book Superman could leap tall buildings in a single bound, but then he had to come back down to Earth. So he could leap buildings with a single bound. In other words, he could jump over them, but he came right back down. He was jumping.
Okay.
He was not flying in the original comic book.
So it wasn't his superpower to fly then in the beginning.
No, just jump. He didn't fly. He just jumped, and he would jump so high, he would go over buildings in a single jump. Hmm. It wasn't until the 1940s when animators for a new animated series decided it would be too difficult to routinely draw him bending his knees that it was decided that Superman could then take off and fly. So it was too hard from an animation perspective for him to be continually bending his knees. So they said, well, we'll just make him fly instead.
Wow.
And there it is. So Superman could fly, but he couldn't always fly.
Interesting.
There's a little, I bet you didn't know that. And take that, Bubinick.
Wow.
We're not sure about yours, what but about we
the,
know
what about
Superman.
The x-ray vision?
Oh.
That'll be another one.
Didn't go into that one. There you go. There's a little, I bet you didn't know that. I know I didn't. And now for Heroes of the Fate.
Man, all
I'm
right.
I'm getting goosebumps.
Me too. My goodness.
It's chilly in here.
Ever been to Duesenberg?
No, I've
We know
not.
You've never been to Guelph.
I've never been to Guelph. I don't think you can get to Duesenberg without going to Guelph.
Probably not. That's gateway of the world, right? Yeah. St. Disibod of Duesenberg.
Okay.
That's a Disenberg. He's also known as Disibold of Rhineland and Disibold the Hermit. But his memorial, he has three of them, so it's kind of interesting. None of them are today, by the way. September 8th, July 8th, and September 9th. But anyway, Disibod traveled from his native Ireland in 640 to live as a pilgrim and a hermit on the banks of the Rhine River near the city of Mainz in modern Germany. Tradition says his traveling companions were named Giswald, Clement, and Sallust. I don't know why they wrote those down, but they did.
They did.
His reputation
some import.
Yeah, for holiness and for wisdom attracted a number of would-be spiritual students, and with them, he built a monastery on the banks of the river Nahn, placing it under the Benedictine rule. Now, legend says that a deer helped pick the construction site by digging up a spring of fresh water, and it was confirmed when Disibod struck his walking stick in the ground and the area became green with plants. Boom. The settlement that grew up around it became the city of Duesenberg. Against his wishes, he was elevated to regional bishop, serving mainly in the rural areas without a fixed diocese and living in a traditionally Irish beehive anchorite's cell.
Wow. He won, I wonder what that is.
Yeah, I know. That's pretty odd. He won many converts in the region and was reported to be a miracle worker. Mm. St. Hildegard of Bingen later stayed in the monastery and wrote a biography of him based on visions that he received. So his legend lives on, and we have St. Hildegard of Bingen really to thank for that, who wrote these things down. And especially, you know, when a deer finds the spot where this is going to be built and he strikes the ground with his walking stick and boom.
A deer?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It. He basically had, let's see, the deer helped pick the construction site by digging up a spring of fresh water.
There you go.
And then that confirmation took place with his walking stick stuck in the ground in that area. And it all became green with plants. So it just must be the spot.
Yeah, needed them both. Yeah. Hey, it's always good to have an indication and then a confirmation.
That's right.
So he had both.
So St. Disibod was born in 619 in Ireland. He died either on July 8th or September 8th. Records do vary on that. In the year 700 of natural causes, and his relics were translated in July or September of 754. Again, the record keeping. But he... kind of an amazing figure, and Irish lore still holds him in high esteem as well. So, by all means, St. Disibod of Duesenberg.
Pray for us. Absolutely love it. And note to self.
Yeah.
Note to self that I have a policy. It's a policy. It's
policy.
Something that I follow and regulate my life by, and that is if you have a difficult word to say, say it quickly, say it confidently,
right,
and you're good. Because 99.9% of people don't know the word anyway.
That's right.
So the only problem you're going to have is when you stumble over it, and then someone says, well, he doesn't know how to say that word. But then I cannot, shan't, won't ever again use the word Guelph.
Guelph.
Guelph. Quickly and confidently, because others know how to say it, and I don't. And so I shan't do that anymore. It makes one look stupid. But it's okay. The policy doesn't always work, but still a policy.
I think it, they named it, somebody had a frog in their throat.
Yeah.
And they said,
wow.
Yeah, there you go.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. That's, say it confidently with a frog in your throat.
Are you going to clean that up? Welcome to Catechism for Today with Father Nicholas Weibel. Lessons for daily life from the Catechism of the Catholic Church.
One Sunday morning, a minister had been telling his congregation that there was a sermon in every blade of grass. The following day, when he was cutting his grass in the vicarage garden, a parishioner who was passing called out, "That's right, vicar, keep them short." And what does the Catechism say about this? Paragraph 76. In keeping with the Lord's command, the gospel is handed on in two ways. Orally, by the apostles who handed on, by the spoken word of their preaching, by the example they gave, by the institutions they established, what they themselves had received, whether from the lips of Christ, from the way of life and his works, or whether they had learned it at the prompting of the Holy Spirit. And paragraph 77, in order that the full and living gospel might always be preserved in the church, the apostles left bishops as their successors. They gave them their own position of teaching authority. Indeed, the apostolic preaching, which is expressed in a special way in their inspired books, was to be preserved for a continuous line of succession until the end of time. In paragraph 875, how are they to believe in of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without a preacher? How can men preach unless they are sent? No one, no individual, and no community can proclaim the gospel to himself. Faith comes from what is heard. No one can give himself the mandate and the mission to proclaim the gospel. The one sent by the Lord does not speak and act on his own authority, but by virtue of Christ's authority, not as a member of the community, but speaking to it in the name of Christ. No one can bestow grace on himself. It must be given and offered. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
You know, Dave, our breaks are just not long enough.
Yeah, not long enough to consume an entire donut.
You've got to eat it in stages.
Just do what I do. One bite. One totally bite. It's like getting to the center of a lollipop. You know, it's just bam. Yeah. You're right there. That's hey, right. I want to talk, before we get into what's going on, yeah, I want to take a moment and tell you about what's going on. All of you got, many of you got letters regarding our special event coming up on March the 14th of next year. With special speaker, special presenter, Father John Ricardo, and opening prayer will be led by Father Mark Davis, by the way. And then nice. Bishop Thomas will also be making a presentation at that event. Many of you have already sent your information in for acquiring your tickets. I wanted to let you know you can also do that online. It's set up on our website for you to purchase your tickets for that event and make your meal selection. Just go to artoledo.com, artoledo.com. These, I will just tell you, these seats, these available seats are going to go very, very quickly. It's going to be a fabulous event. You don't want to miss it. So if you've not yet purchased your tickets for being a part of that event, go to artoledo.com. You'll see it at the very top of the website. You can get right in and make your reservations and make your meal selection.
Yeah, Pinnacle's a big place, but yeah, like you say, this is going to fill up.
Yeah, because it's a seated dinner, so yeah, you can exactly get a whole bunch of people in there sitting in chairs, but yeah, this is a seated dinner, mm-hmm, and it's going to be a fabulous dinner, and I've used fabulous three times, but I say it because, let me think, it's fabulous. It's going to be absolutely incredible, and we just don't want you to miss it.
I can't remember a time when we had
this was my other thought. If you're thinking about a Christmas gift, no better Christmas gift than this. Get your loved one a ticket to be a part of these presentations by Father John Ricardo and our own Bishop Thomas.
It's going to be fabulous. March 14th.
Oh, there, you said it.
It's going to be incredible.
It's confirmation. Yeah, see, there needed to be an indication and confirmation, and we got them both.
Perfect. Just like being
what else is going on, Mr. Finn?
Well, a few things are going on, although it's pretty much winding down. After all, we're running out of year here. But everybody's invited on, tomorrow, Tuesday, to St. Peter's Catholic Church in Huron for Illuminate. This is a candlelit night of reflection and confession to ready our hearts for the birth of Jesus. It's sponsored by the Sandusky and Huron Catholic communities. evening of worship featuring the Amplify Band, and they'll have four priests available for confession, child care provided. This is at 6:30 p.m. tomorrow.
Nice.
And then Tuesday, January 9th, the Night of Healing, get ready for that in Tiffin. It's going to be a worship word healing at St. Joseph Tiffin. Father Anthony Cosi, Father James Brown, and Father Kevin Mobius on hand for that. So that's going to be a good one. And then, you know, as we get into January, we have a few more events going on.
But, yeah, whole lot coming up. And in the meantime, praying for you as you continue on your Advent journey, which ends halfway through Sunday.
Yeah, what, 6 hours of week four, right?
And then getting right into the Christmas season. Mm-hmm. Father Mark Davis in the house. Before we get, even before I introduce the word of the day, and we can look this up online because I didn't give you any heads up on this, but you might know. Can you share with folks your schedule for Christmas Eve and Christmas Day?
Absolutely. First of all, because there was something going on a minute ago, tonight at St. Patrick's of Heather Down, starting at 7, is our Advent Taizé prayer service.
Oh, wow.
So Taizé prayer came out of France. It's chanting, it's quiet, and there's candles and stories.
I've been there for it. It's fabulous.
It is. Anybody who's been to it, you know, always comes back. It is really, it's just so nice. It's simple. Mm-hmm. It doesn't even take an hour. But I invite all of you just to come and have a little quiet for Advent tonight at 7. Mm-hmm. You'll be really glad that you came.
Okay.
So it's interesting. So this coming Sunday will be in the morning. We'll have 7:30 and 9:30 Mass for the
7:30 and 9:30
in the morning for the fourth Sunday of Advent.
Right.
So Christmas Eve is 4, 6, and 11.
Okay.
And 4 o'clock will be in church and in the Holy Family Center.
Oh, nice.
Okay. So 4, 6, and 11. As in most churches, if 4 o'clock is the only time you could come, please come. But the other masses, you know, in most parishes like ours are a little less crowded, you know, than 4. And then on Christmas Day, we have 9 and 11. So it's a little bit different.
But that's a lot of opportunity.
We have 4, 6, and 11 on Christmas Eve. That's Sunday night. And then we have 9 and 11 on Monday. I'll have the 11 o'clock on Christmas morning, and I'll have the 4 p.m. in church and the 11 p.m. on Sunday night.
Wow. And then Tuesday you shall rest.
Yes.
I shall rest.
For a few days.
I shall go out of town.
Yeah. That's right. And so before we get to Word Day, real quickly, you've got retreat coming up.
Yes, in January.
Good.
In January. So, all right, see how good of a psychic you are, Ron and Dave. Since you gave me the word rescue, what song's been in my head?
Rescue me.
Oh, why didn't I think
Take
of that?
Take me in your arms,
oh,
rescue me.
Oh, no, I've been thinking, do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. I'll come to your emotional rescue.
Emotional rescue. Yeah, there you go.
So, why didn't the lifeguard rescue the hippie?
Why didn't the lifeguard rescue the hippie? I don't know.
He was too far out, man.
Now hit our word of the day music here, because I need to announce our word of the day.
We already did that.
No, we didn't. I stopped us.
No, I think he did.
Oh, yeah, you played the music, but I didn't announce it.
It's the Monday
of the third week of Advent. Yeah, it's Monday, December the 18th, and our word for today is rescue.
So, two prawns are swimming in the sea. One's name is Justin, and one's name is Christian. And they're always...
I'm sorry, this is funny already.
Yeah, right.
So they're swimming around, and they're always being chased by sharks. And Justin just says one day, I can't take this anymore. I wish I was a shark, so I didn't have to be afraid of them. And there was a mysterious cod, you know, swimming by, and he said, your wish is granted. Poof! And so Justin became a shark. Justin became a shark, and Christian swims away. He's freaked out. He thinks he's going to eat him. So then this goes on for a few days, and none of Justin's friends want anywhere near him because they think he's going to eat them. And finally he goes to the cod and says, I got to be turned back to a prawn. I just can't take this. None of my friends, you know, will pay attention to me. And so he turned it back into a prawn. And so he swims, you know, to the gate and he goes to Christian's house and he knocks. And he says, it's me, Justin. I'm turned back into a prawn. No, you're not. You're a shark. You just want to eat me. No, really, buddy. It's me. Really. I've changed. I've seen cod. I'm a prawn again, Christian.
Now, it took me a minute because I couldn't catch up with why we weren't talking about chess. I thought prawns were in chess.
So,
that's funny.
That joke was so bad yeah. on Saturday night, I had to get a new one yeah. for yesterday.
Yeah, I can see that one.
So,
yeah.
guys, there's a rare book dealer who's traveling in Germany. He's at a pub. You know, and he's talking to a guy. He says, yeah, you collect books. I had an old Bible. It passed in through my German family for years and years. And it was all musty. It was a mess. I just threw it away. It was printed by Gutenberg? That was the first book printed. It's worth like $500,000. Not this one. It was scribbled in the margins by some guy named Martin Luther.
There you go.
Okay.
All right. So
the word is rescue. And sometimes we feel like we're just too way out there because we think rescue is about staying in one place and doing nothing but praying and just expecting God to come rescue us. So the psalmist, you know, says, for he shall rescue the poor when he cries out and the afflicted when he has no one to help him. Now, sometimes we do have to have people come to us. But I think this time of year, when we talk about Advent and we talk about rescue and God being sending a Savior to get us, I think about that story about the book is that sometimes we have things of great value that we don't realize. Sometimes, because that's all the readings for the Pink Sunday yesterday, Gaudete, was all about, candles are pink, but real priests do not wear pink. No, so here's the thing. Sometimes they said to rejoice. Paul says rejoice no matter what happens. Mm. Whether you're in jail, you're sick, people are dying, you are in war, because God is here. Jesus is here, and God is all around us, and we have more than we think we do. And so we need to rejoice and to be able to focus on being a bringer of light to people who don't have it. And that's why we don't want to act like sharks. We want to be who we were created to be. And we don't want to be too far out. And if we want God to rescue us, it's not just about waiting for him, about rejoicing. Where is God in my life? Where is the good? Where is the Spirit? And remember that Jesus came quiet at night, silent, right? And so let's open our hearts this last week of Advent and let us, you know, be bearers of good news and light to those who need to be rescued. May God bless you. Have a wonderful Advent week.
Thank you, Father Mark.
Thank you, Father Mark.